So I started growing tepary beans because one of the things I like to do with Landrace Gardening is I like diversity in my garden. So rather than growing just one variety of bean, I like to grow as many different varieties of beans as I can, as many different species as I can. And in that way, if the weather is warmer or cooler or rainier or drier, some bean or other that I'm growing is likely to like the changing conditions. And so I started growing tepary beans because they're a different species. And they're a short season species that typically grows by germinating with the summer monsoons. And then before frost, they have grown so quickly that they can produce a harvest. When I originally started growing tepary beans, I could only find one variety of tepary bean, and that was the gray speckled tepary bean. It's the most common and widespread tepary bean. It grew fine in my garden, but I like my colors and my diversity. And so I started looking around for other beans. And I had a friend, and she was growing a landrace of tepary beans. She had three or four colors of tepary beans in her landrace. And so she sent me some seeds for that. And so I had like three colors. I planted those, and most of those died as well. There were a few plants that did okay. So then I had like four colors of tepary beans. You know, it was nice and it was different and it was moving in the direction of diversity. And then I had a friend, and he was doing meticulous work of opening up the bean flowers and cross-pollinating different kinds of tepary beans. So he shared that seed with me. I was used to tepary beans sort of being this crop that doesn't grow very well for me and it hardly produces any seeds. But when I got his manual crosses and they were hybrids, they just thrived and they're like, wah! And because they were hybrids, they were throwing out all kinds of different colors of seeds and different patterns and different shapes and different tone quality on the seed. Some of them were more glossy and some of them were more flat. So just a lot of diversity showed up from that. And then the genetics of those were rearranging so rapidly in the next couple of generations, I was able to select for some tepary beans that really thrived for me. Where previously the inbred varieties, you know, they did okay, but I just wasn't thrilled with them. But then all of a sudden I had all these new varieties that were just doing really well. And tepary beans went from being a, you know, a burden to being something that just thrived. I grow all of my beans jumbled up together. And because they're jumbled up together, the flowers are an inch apart or a couple inches apart, less than a foot apart. And so that increases the likelihood that any natural crosses will be hybrids. And anything I can do to encourage the hybrids, I really like. With common beans, the way that I started the common bean project is I went to the grocery store and I bought a package of 15 bean seed. And that is intended for making soup. But I was able to buy a pound of bean seeds for like $2. Out of that package of bean seeds, there was the pinto beans and the pink beans that really thrived in my garden. And the rest of them, I think, died out pretty soon after. So I got two varieties of beans out of that. And then people says, oh, you're growing beans. So people started mailing me bean seeds. They were all varieties of bean seeds that people were sending me. So they'd send me like their navy beans and their pinto beans and their rattlesnake beans or whatever. About 70% of them were too long season for me and they didn't make seeds, which is wonderful. Because then they self-eliminate and I don't have to worry about them. And one thing about the hybrids is at my place, I like to select for bush beans because I don't have to trellis them and they're shorter season and easier for me to harvest. Because if I'm harvesting a bush bean, I just pull up the whole plant, bash it against the garbage can, and the seeds fall out and I'm done harvesting. But if I'm picking pole beans that are on a trellis, then I got to pick individual pods. On the beans, I'm selecting for promiscuous pollination, sort of inadvertent. But if I'm planting the natural hybrids, then the plants that I planned are those that were more likely to be promiscuous. And I might be moving the promiscuity from, say, 1% up to 3% or 5%, but it's still movement in the direction of being more promiscuous. And also because I'm planting them different varieties right next to each other, that also increases the likelihood that they might be cross-pollinating. And then just watching and seeing when a bean is different than I've ever seen before, that's usually a good indication that it's a hybrid. So one thing that my beans did over the years is they became short season, which is really important to me because I have between 85 and 100 days frost-free most years. And so anything that I grow has to be really fast to produce. So they're like a month earlier. So the beans followed the same trajectory during domestication that the tomatoes did. And that is farmers, if they were finding natural hybrids in their fields, they were trashing those natural hybrids. And so the population tended to be selected inadvertently, probably, for beans that were the most inbreeding that could be found. So I'm doing what little bit I can to undo that selection for inbreeding by intentionally selecting for outcrossing.
The bean plants that people are used to, would you say they have inbreeding depression that we just don't see or don't know because we think that is normal?
My thoughts regarding beans, people say, oh, beans don't have inbreeding depression. But what I think is actually going on is all of the varieties of beans have inbreeding depression. And we're comparing them to other beans that have inbreeding depression. And so it's like, whoa. But when I grow hybrid beans, I notice a lot of vigor and a lot of productivity. The thing about making a bean hybrid, for one cross-pollination attempt, you might get 3 or 4 or 5 seeds. And so it's really labor intensive to make a bean hybrid. But I have friends that make bean hybrids and they've shared seeds with me. And it's a wonderful way to really add a lot of vigor to your garden and to select for varieties that are more locally adapted.